hope that you will you're prepared to learn a lot today. I've got a lot of information to cover about a lot of different things. Today we're going to talk specifically about physiology, the five paces of running, individualization, developing a training calendar, racing strategies and responses, and some resources that I found useful in my coaching career and that hopefully you will also find useful. So let's get started right off the bat with physiology. The first thing that I want to talk about is to dispel a myth. There's a very popular myth in exercise circles. Maybe it's not popular, it's a saying that we've all heard though, and it's that no pain, no gain is a lie. And anyone who ever told you that you have to be in pain to get an effective workout is just not telling the truth, right? They're absolutely mistaken about what they're saying. So let's talk about that. We're gonna have to cover a couple of things in here. Energy systems. And there are two main energy systems that we deal with in distance running, right? We're gonna skip ATP. ATP is adenine triphosphate, and it is for sprints. It's short distance work only. It's for quick bursts of energy, which are of course very useful, but they don't help us in the distances, 800 meters on out to the marathon. And we're going to talk about the aerobic energy system. Aerobic means with oxygen. And then we're going to talk about the anaerobic energy system, which is without oxygen. You need to make sure that we keep those things absolutely clear. There are two components to distance running as far as energy goes, and they are aerobic and anaerobic. Now, we have to think about them in a couple different ways. Aerobic energy, the aerobic system, you can use aerobic energy to burn fats or to burn carbohydrates. Now, we all know that fats have 9 calories per gram, right, versus 4 calories per gram of carbohydrates. So if you could burn 1 gram of fuel, you'd want to burn fat because it's more efficient, and you'd get twice as much energy production out of a gram of fat as you do out of a gram of carbohydrates. But here's the counterintuitive thing. It's going to come back to no pain, no gain. To burn fat, you have to be going at a slower speed than to burn carbohydrates. Aerobic glycolysis happens at slower rates. So the next thing we're going to have to talk about is thresholds. There are various thresholds for energy consumption, and we'll need to cover a couple of those. And so let me erase this board here, and we'll talk about the next things. All right, so let's talk about the thresholds that we need to pay attention to. Okay. There are a couple of thresholds. And threshold is, of course, the breaking point between two things. So we're going to talk about our aerobic threshold and the anaerobic threshold, which is sometimes called the lactate threshold. Okay. The aerobic threshold is approximately 70%. Some say it's as high as 70% or 75% of max heart rate. And what this means is that above that aerobic threshold, your body begins to use blood glycogen, right, carbohydrates, as a fuel source without the use of oxygen as a catalyst. Right, so above this line, you're beginning to use oxygen to transport fuel waste out rather than to help in the catalytic conversion of carbohydrates into energy. You want to train below the threshold. You want to train below the aerobic threshold in order to develop the most beneficial adaptations for your body. Right? Among the adaptations that happen when you're training aerobically, are an increase in mitochondria. These are the little muscles. They're the little engines in the muscles. Right? You're going to increase red blood cells. Right? And this increase in red blood cells will allow you to carry more oxygen to the muscles as they're running. And you're going to train your body to become, as Roy Benson says, a better butter burner. You want to train your body to be able to burn fat the most efficiently. And in order to do that, you have to increase your mitochondria, increase the red blood cells, and also become a better butter burner. That's what you want to do. Okay. But it requires you to run at about 70% of your maximum heart rate. If you're training higher than 70% of your max heart rate, then some people say 75% is still aerobic. And of course, it is, but to train at 70%, that's pretty easy. And a good guideline for 70% is, can I speak out loud, right? Can I go at a conversational pace? Conversational pace. Can you do it? Can you talk the entire time of your run? It's kind of a big deal. You can measure it with a heart rate monitor. I've got my trusty Pollard heart rate monitor on. There are other ways you can measure it. We'll talk about that later. That's your aerobic threshold. You want to stay below that when you're training aerobically. The other threshold that we're going to talk about is the anaerobic threshold. And the anaerobic threshold is the point where your body can no longer keep up with the amount of muscle waste that's being produced by this harder intensity work. Right? There's this spectrum, right, or graph or curve or whatever, of how hard you're working and what your body is producing as a result of it. Aerobic glycolysis produces as a waste or as a byproduct only carbon dioxide and water. Those are the only byproducts of aerobic glycolysis. So it converts these carbohydrates or these fats and produces energy and then carbon dioxide and water. And those get flushed out through the system. Okay? That's pretty simple. But when you go to anaerobic glycolysis, all sorts of things happen. Right? Your body is able to convert those carbohydrates into energy without the oxygen, but the oxygen is suddenly being used to clear out muscle waste. Right? I'm going to use a word, the name of something that is controversial, right? But lactic acid, right? The old lactic acid, we've heard about it. We say, oh yeah, that's what locks up your muscles. There is some research that suggests that lactic acid cannot stay in the muscles and that it won't stick around. And whether or not that's really the case, we do know that the lactate threshold, right, it's a measurement of blood lactate in the blood, is a pretty easily identifiable line where your body can no longer keep up with the muscle waste, whatever that waste is made up of, can no longer keep up with that muscle waste as it goes in. Right? So you imagine that you've got a cup, right, and this cup has a hole in the side of it, and as you're pouring water into the cup, there's a speed where you can pour the water in and it'll go out that hole at the bottom at the same rate. Right? That's the threshold of the cup's ability to keep that stuff in there. Right? Imagine that's your muscles, and you're pouring in the muscle waste into the top, and your body is clearing it out with oxygen through the hole. Well, if you start to pour at a higher rate, the blood lactate will fill up slowly in the cup, right, faster than it can get rid of it, and it'll reach a point where it can no longer stay in the cup. That's the shutdown point. Whether or not it's lactic acid doesn't really matter. We do know that there is a training threshold, a line where you can just barely keep up with what you're doing. That's an important threshold to keep in mind. It is approximately 88% of max heart rate. Daniels calls it comfortably hard. It's a comfortably hard pace. It's a pace that you can keep up for about 1 hour in a race condition, right? 88%. This lactate threshold is a big deal. It's slightly faster, well, actually it's significantly faster than your aerobic pace, right? Which is 70%, and it's slightly slower than your 5 kilometer pace, right? It approximates about 10K pace for average runners, and a lot of elite runners, say Ryan Hall, one of those guys who runs the half marathon in under an hour, that they're probably running at their lactate threshold pace. So that's really important to know those two thresholds. Now, these are measurements in max percentage of max heart rate, but a heart rate monitor costs 30 to who knows how much, right? You can spend as much as you want on a heart rate monitor if you want to train with a heart rate monitor, which is going to lead me to my next thing of physiology. This is research done by Jack Daniels, PhD, and we'll talk about the correlation between maximum heart rate or percentages of max heart rate and velocity. Okay. Now we have to know something about this. So we've got to start with the idea of VO2 max. Now VO2, V is for volume, O2 obviously is oxygen max, right? What is the maximum volume of oxygen that you can pump through your body, right? Per minute or per whatever, right? What's the maximum amount? There is a limit to each runner's capacity of VO2 max. So how do we measure that? Well, you could go do a treadmill test, get a VO2 max test, or you can find something that correlates with it really closely. And that is your velocity at VO2 max. There's a little V in front of VO2 there. Right? Velocity at VO2 max is what we're talking about. Now, your velocity at VO2 max is the speed that you're going when your O2 or your VO2 max hits. Right. So let's say black is speed, right? And your speed increases. This is obviously it's going to be a little bit off scale, but what's going to happen here if black is speed, right, or velocity, and your oxygen consumption, right? Your velocity of oxygen or volume of oxygen consumption is increasing steadily at the same time. There will be a point where your heart cannot carry any more oxygen, right, than it's got. It can't beat any faster. You don't have any more volume of blood, and there are some limiting factors, right? But there's a point that you cross there where your heart stops beating more. You can't carry any more oxygen out to your muscles. That's your VO2 max. Even though you can go faster than that in speed, right? Even though you can go faster than that pace, right? There is a line where your body just can't pump any more blood. Does that make sense? Okay, so this is your velocity at VO2 max. And if that's 100%, okay, if that's 100% of your velocity at VO2 max, then there are some other things that are going to correlate with that. Now, it's interesting that heart rate also correlates with this. Okay? Heart rate also correlates with your velocity at VO2 max and also with your speed. And so if we know that you can't go over 100% heart rate, right? But you can go faster past 100%. You know, you can be at 100% and still run faster than that. It's just that your heart can't go any faster. You can run faster. And so approximately, right, 100% heart rate is correlated with certain speeds. Well, the training intensities we're going to deal with are also correlated with those. So if we talked about that aerobic pace is 70% of heart rate, right? They'll say it's really 60 to 75% of max heart rate is your aerobic training zone. And if you go towards the 60% of that max heart rate, you're burning more fat. Right? And if you're training more towards 75, you're burning more carbohydrates, but you're also developing a little bit more of the mitochondria, those kinds of things. That's your aerobic threshold, right around 75%. But in velocity of VO2 max, the same is true. Right? It's approximately 60 to 70% of velocity at VO2 max is the aerobic training zone. And So you can calculate how fast a person should be going to train in their aerobic zone by speed, rather than with a heart rate or with a blood lactate machine where, you know, at the end of every repetition or at the end of every 20 minutes, you poke the guy in the finger and you put it on the stick and measure his blood lactate. There are schools that do that, even here in my own town. Right, there are schools that have a blood lactate machine, and you know, all sorts of scientific research goes into that, but they're expensive. You know, at $1 per test strip, right? Plus each kid has to have his own sterile needle that's just his and doesn't share with anybody else. That can be pretty expensive, and you know, chances are that probably most of you runners can't afford, you know, $1 per session, you know, or per 20 minutes per session of a workout to measure your blood lactate level and make sure you're running in the right zones. So we'll start with that, okay? So how do we know what our velocity at VO2 max is? It's a really good question. Okay, so we're gonna go through the five running paces, and we'll give you an example of one runner and his velocity at VO2 max. Okay, let me clear the board here, and we'll get some more information about it. What we're gonna talk about next are the five training paces for distance running. And so these are the five paces. I'm gonna go in order of intensity. The first one is aerobic base training pace. And aerobic base pace, for what I use, is 70% of velocity at VO2 max. Okay. Marathon race pace is a training pace that is only used by marathoners. Okay. It's calculated at 84% of velocity at VO2 max. This is all based on research from years and years and years of stuff done by Jack Daniels PhD, and other physiologists from USA Track and Field and other elite circles. They say that a marathoner can only run at about 84% of his velocity at VO2 max. Right, so if you compare a marathon runner's velocity at VO2 max with his pace overall in a marathon, they're about 84%. Even from elite to the slowest of the slow, they're approximately 84%. So that's where that comes from. The next one is lactate threshold pace. That's 88% of velocity, backwards, of velocity at VO2 max. Then we have VO2 max development. We're trying to improve aerobic power. VO2 max development. And we're going to train at 98% of velocity at VO2 max. And then running economy reps. I'll talk about each of these as we get them, but running economy repetitions are about 110% to as much as 120% of velocity at VO2 max. And so we're going to give each one of these its due, but we're going to start with how you get there. Right? To establish your current baseline, right? Regardless of fast runner, slow runner, each person needs to establish their own baseline. Each runner should have his own baseline. So you do that by doing a test, a time trial. You can do a 5K time trial, right? You can use a race, a recent race time, or you can go do a specific time trial. I like to do a 2 mile time trial. This is based on the idea. Remember the old Cooper test? It's a 12 minute test. You go have an athlete go out and run 12 minutes, see how far they can go, and then you figure out how fast they were going. Right, 12 minutes is approximately their velocity at VO2 max. That's the maximum they can do. I do a 2 mile test because, you know, what standard distance is approximately 12 minutes? Right, 2 miles. It's a great starting point, and we call that their velocity at VO2 max. Now, for the sake, the ease of explanation here, we're going to use an athlete who runs a 12-minute 2-mile. Right, you go out and you try a 2-mile race or 2-mile time trial, and the time comes up as 12 minutes right, for a 2 mile race. Okay. 12 minutes is 6 minutes per mile, and we'll use that as our starting point. Their velocity at VO2 max is a 6 minute mile, right? That's 10 miles an hour. That's why it's so easy, right? It's 10. So if aerobic base pace is 70% of that, right, that's 0.7 on your, or 7.0 on your treadmill, 7.0 on your treadmill, and that's 8 minutes and 34 per mile. So on their easy day aerobic based training runs, right, that athlete is going to run 8:34 per mile, give or take 15, 20 seconds, right? Because it could be as fast as about 75% and could be slower. Right? This is great for training groups. You don't have to train with somebody who's exactly your speed. Right? Train 15, 20 seconds slower either direction or faster, right, and still be training aerobically pretty well. Okay, 84%, right, 8.4 miles per hour on the treadmill is 7:09 per mile. That's only for marathon runners. And Daniels calls this the no man's land, the area between aerobic base pace and lactate threshold pace. If you are running faster than aerobic base pace on your easy runs, you're not running easy. Right? You're not going to get the physiological adaptations that you want out of running if you run 84%. And you're not running conversationally. You're not taking care of your body like you need to. You're not giving yourself those adaptations, the mitochondria, the red blood cells, etc. This is actually a really comfortable pace. Most people can run 84%, right, or 82% for all their daily runs, right, and feel fine. But they're not getting all the benefits that they need. Right? If you want to improve your recovery time between hard interval bouts, you should be doing aerobic base days at 70%. If you're training here, you're not actually training aerobically. So we got to watch out for that. That's a significant difference. A minute 25 per mile, that's a huge deal. Okay. Lactate threshold, 8.8 on your treadmill, if again, if you're a 12-minute 2-miler. Right? And that's 6:49 per mile. That's only 20 seconds faster than marathon training pace, but that's a full, what, minute and 45? 145 per mile faster. That's significantly faster. Now, that breaks down to a 414 kilometer or a 142 400 per lap. And that's lactate threshold. Put that right there. Okay. The next training pace is VO2 max development, where we're trying to stress the aerobic system to improve the capacity of oxygen-enriched blood that's carried through the system. And that's at 98%, so 9.8 miles per hour is 6:07 per mile, right, or 3:48 per kilometer, or 1:31 per 400 meter lap. And then finally, the things that we call overspeed, right? These aren't, you know, sprints by any means. When you go out and do a session of repeat 400s, right, or 200s, whatever the case may be, right, you're going at 110% of your velocity at VO2 max. That's a minute 21 per 400, or about 41, 40 and a half, let's call it 41 per 200 meters, right, on the track, running economy days. Now, these are all based on this number up here, that 12-minute 2-mile time trial that your athlete did. 6 minutes per mile is 100%, so 70% of that speed is 8:34 per mile, 84% of that is 7:09 per mile, 88% of that is 6:49 per mile, 98% of that is 6:07 per mile. That makes sense? So we start there. We start with the baseline. We say, okay, Johnny, you're running, you know, a 12-minute 2-mile, so we can calculate how fast you should be going on all the different days of the week. This is essential stuff to know. Now, of course it will change. Of course it will change. Right? About 6 weeks into the cycle, right, the body has made the adaptation it's going to make, and you need to do one of two things. Well, you need to add a stress, and you can do it one of two ways. You can increase the volume. Right, you could change the amount of mileage that they're doing at these exact paces to continue to make improvements, or you can change the speeds. Now, say, you know, 4 weeks into the season or 5 weeks into the season,
right? You run a 5K again, and you go, oh man, my, or you run another 2 mile race, right? And your time improves 30 or 40 seconds over the mile, right? Well, you adjust these times accordingly and keep training at them, right? Those are the five paces, right? And that's one way to do it. You could calculate them out by saying how many miles per hour this is and figure out in miles per hour how fast these things are. Okay. Now, people often ask me about running economy. I see the hand. I suspect that's what you're going to ask me about. How can running economy be over 100% of your velocity? If I'm only capable of running 6 minute miles, how can I run faster than that? Remember, this is a 2 mile test. Your absolute best in 2 miles, and it's 100% of your 2 mile speed. Right? This is 110% of that. This is 120%. Any kid or athlete, any athlete who can run a 12 minute 2 mile can certainly run faster than 41 seconds for half a lap. But these are not sprints. These are under control repetitions. They are intended to help develop running economy, right? It makes you faster overall. It gives you more biomechanical efficiency. You run those 200s and 400s not to improve your energy system, but to improve your efficiency as you run. These times and paces make sense to everybody though, otherwise? Good, okay. So, I guess we'll start the next bit, which will be about developing your training calendar, now that we've talked a little bit about individualization. I'll take care of this, and we'll start up the next piece. All right, so we're going to talk about training calendar and how to set it up. And so you're going to develop your training calendar, and you got to remember a couple important things. There are four phases to periodization. Okay, so periodization. It's broken up in four phases. Okay, phase number one is general preparation. Phase number two is event-specific training. Phase number three is the competition phase. And phase four is the peak performance phase. Peak performance phase. And so we start with this idea that there are four phases of four phases of periodization. And you got to figure out how long you've got until your most important race. And if you're coaching high school or collegiate level, right, probably the most important races are those qualifiers at the end of the season. The regional championship meet might be the state track meet. If you've obviously got a top runner, you're going to figure out when the most important race is. Okay, so high school seasons are generally 12 weeks long, which is not nearly enough. Jack Daniels says 24 weeks is a great season length. Right. So let's pretend that we've got a 16-week season, and just make a happy medium. The first thing you do is you divide it in four. Right. So if I've got 16 weeks until my championship race that I want my kid to run his best at, right, then each of these weeks gets four. 4 weeks of general prep, 4 weeks of event-specific, 4 weeks of competition phase. And or 4 weeks of competition and 4 weeks of peak performance. 4 weeks for each phase. You want to divide the season pretty evenly, and each of those phases has a different goal. And so we're going to call them phase 1, 2, 3, and 4. I'm going to get rid of these descriptors of them up here. Right? And we're going to start by talking about what the goals of each of the phases are and what we expect athletes to accomplish during these phases. So phase 1, the general preparation, is aerobic base building. And because we're doing distance running, we want to build the most important part during the general preparation phase. Regardless of whether your athlete is running at 800 meters or the marathon, this general preparation phase is 4 weeks of base building. Right? It's almost entirely, and I actually try and make my athletes run entirely aerobic-based training races, runs for these days. Right? They shouldn't do anything except for aerobic-based building on those days. This is the time to build up mileage, to build up those red blood cells, build up those mitochondria without other stresses, allowing them to recover. So at the beginning, we do their baseline fitness, and we do this. We do weeks and weeks of this. And then we move to event-specific training, and the second most important threshold for distance runners is lactate threshold development. Right? So we're going to work on lactate threshold, and we're going to work on some running economy as our secondary goal. Running economy as our secondary goal. Then during phase three, our goal is VO2 max, that's aerobic capacity development, VO2 max, and lactate threshold development. The lactate threshold is actually a trainable threshold. You can get your body to flush out waste more efficiently by training at that threshold. So we're going to spend a lot of time in these two. This is the really hard phase. All right. During competitions, we're going to increase how much VO2 max work we're doing simply by racing in regular races and also by doing specific training days geared towards lactate threshold work. And then finally, phase four, our competition peak performance phase, we're going to focus on maintenance and peaking. Right. So we're going to do some lactate threshold work combined with some VO2 max work, and then our secondary goals, we got primary and secondary goals for the latter phases. Our secondary goals for that phase is running economy, which is the same at that point as really developing finishing kick, right? So how do you build a calendar for training? Well, you need to look at how many days of the week you're going to have your kids train, have your athletes train. And so if I start, and so phase one, two, three, four, everybody got what you need here? You can get it out of the notes later. All right, so how many days of the week can you train? Now, I coach at a high school, and I have my kids train 6 days a week, and my athletes train 6 days a week. And so we'll set up our thing. We go Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday is always off. Okay? Sunday is always off. So for phase one, we're doing aerobic-based training. And so in phase one, I'm going to do basically just 4 weeks that are going to look like the whole calendar. Phase one, get rid of periodization there. So this is our training calendar. Phase one looks like this. Okay. Blue will be my marker for easy. Okay. We're going to do, say, an easy 30 minutes, easy 30 minutes, an easy 30 minutes, an easy 30 minutes, an easy 30 minutes, and then a long run of about 65 minutes, 60 to 65 minutes. Okay. Long run can be about double what the daily mileage is. It shouldn't be more than a quarter of the weekly mileage, not more than a quarter of the weekly mileage, it should be at the same pace. It might be at the faster end of 60 to 75%, or so you might run a little bit faster than your 70% pace on the long run, on the long run day to keep tempo, but you want to make sure that it's still aerobic. It cannot be that marathon training pace, otherwise you're not going to recover. 30 minutes is the minimum. Okay, now this is a physiology thing. I probably should have mentioned it before, but to burn through all the blood glycogen and start burning fats in the body, you got to exercise at least 20 minutes. And there are, I totally forgot the word. There are hormones, thanks. Hormones in the body that cause the heart to develop and grow more muscle tissue. Right? And those don't kick in, especially in women, until at least 30 minutes of exercise. So 30 minutes is my minimum. Right? Athletes come to me and they say, how far are we going to run today? And I don't tell them distances usually. Most of the time, I say times. I say, you're going to run 30 to 45 minutes. My experienced kids might run 30, might run 45 minutes, maybe even as much as an hour on a regular weekday, easy day during this general preparation phase. Right? But if I say a half hour, right, a kid whose easy day time, his aerobic base pace is 8:40s, right, he's going to run nearly 4 miles in 30 minutes. But if I've got a kid whose 2 mile time trial was 15 minutes, right, that's 7:30 per mile base pace, right, his or 7:30 miles VO2 max pace, his aerobic base training pace is probably more like 9:40s. And so he might only run 3 miles. And then my super fast kid who runs a 4:30 mile, right, he ran 9:40 for the 2 mile, well, his easy day pace is 6:30, you know, 6:25s, somewhere in there. He's going to run nearly 5 miles in 30 minutes. So I don't tell him distances, because you don't want to make athletes run outside of their individualized zone. And so 30 minutes to 45 minutes Monday through Friday, and then a long run on Saturday. The long run is a great and super beneficial thing, and it helps not only with aerobic endurance, but also guts. Right? A kid who's gone out and run for 75 minutes in a row at this easy pace, while it might be an easy overall pace, right, the cumulative effect of it is that it's pretty hard and he's got a lot of work to do. Okay, so that's phase one. We generally going to run about that. Right? Now, a lot of people ask me about, well, how do you increase mileage? Well, a couple ways. You might lengthen the time here. Right? You might say, okay, in week six of this, we're going to be doing definitely at a minimum 45 minutes on these daily runs, and your long run's got to be 75 minutes. You can do that. That's one way. The other way to do it is to just allow their speed to catch up with them. Right? If they train for a half hour to 45 minutes every day right now, and they're 12-minute 2-milers, 6 or 8 weeks down the road when they're 11-minute 2-milers and their aerobic base pace changes, okay, they're going to increase the total distance that they run in that regular time. Does that make sense? Okay. It's not super complicated, okay, but their improvements will naturally increase their mileage a safe amount. Daniels and others, Roy Benson, Runner's World, all those guys, say that 10% a week is a reasonable amount to increase, which I think is a little bit crazy. If you actually had 10% per week every week for 10 weeks, you'd be doing a lot of mileage pretty soon. I like to reevaluate every 4 weeks and then use 10% as a guide. I think another one that Daniel says is that you can add 1 mile per week, 1 mile to the week, per workout you do during the week. So if you work out 6 days a week, you could add 6 miles to the next week, which would be probably more than 10% here, because now you're not running 60 miles this week. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's phase one. Phase two, right, where we're doing running economy and lactate threshold. That's phase one. Phase two, again, you look at your week. I've got Sunday off. That's a recovery day from the long run, and you want to go easy hard. Sometimes I do 2 hard days in a row to make sure that athletes run at the right pace for them, make sure that they're not overexerting themselves in a workout. Can be a really good idea to prevent them from doing that. But I like to do Tuesday, Thursday hard days. Okay, those are going to be the hard days. I'm going to keep this the same, 30 to 45 minutes easy on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And then the long run, again, is going to be maybe 60 to 90 minutes, right, on Saturday during phase two. But their hard workouts those days are going to be lactate threshold workouts, or which we usually do Tuesdays. We do LT runs on Tuesdays. Wish I had orange for this. LT on Tuesdays and running economy on Thursdays. My staple workout for running economy is 2x200 plus 400 with equal jog rest in between them. And so they end up running 1600 meters per per set of this that they do. And, because they're going to go run a 200 at running economy speed, jog a 200 recovery, run a 200, jog a 200, run a 400, jog a 400. Pretty simple. Okay. Lactate threshold days, you either do repeats of 800 meters or 1,000, and you do those at lactate threshold speed. If you do repeats, 800 or 1,000, you give them 1 minute rest in between cycles, or you can do steady state tempo runs of 20 to 30 minutes. Now, that's going to be pretty fast. A 20 to 30 minute run at LT is going to be pretty hard for most athletes to start out at. Okay. So, let me write that down, and then we'll move on to phase three. And so we do probably repeat 800 meters or thousands plus 1 minute rest between each. That's what a staple workout is for phase two. All right, so we're going to talk about phase three, which is the competition phase. And in phase three, we're going to do more aerobic capacity work. And we're going to continue with the lactate threshold work to maintain that. And so aerobic capacity work helps your body deal with the muscle waste buildup as it's in the body. Right? It's not we're trying to flush it out, right, more efficiently. We're trying to deal with the difficulty of having it in there. You know, how do you keep your body moving when it's starting to lock up because of that lactate threshold stuff? So phase three is just like the other two phases, right, in that Tuesday, Thursday are the hard days again. Hey, I love that Daniels calls them quality days. That's one of my favorite things is he calls them quality days. And I actually say that to my kids. And tomorrow's a quality day. And they go, oh, quality days, I hate that. Right. So Monday again, 30 to 45 minutes. Wednesday, 30 to 45 minutes easy. Friday, 30 to 45 minutes easy. And then Saturdays are becoming, generally you've got a race on Saturdays a lot of these times during the season. But if you don't, you still try and do 60 to 90 minutes long run, or we race. Okay. A VO2 max workout, right? This is the key to the VO2 max workout, is that it's 5 minutes max per repetition. Right? So for our 12-minute two-miler, whose mile pace at VO2 max is 6:07, he's not going to do a mile. And maybe you do 1200s. Right? I still like to do thousands. Right? So I might do 4 by 1,000 meters at VO2 pace. And VO2 max pace, that's 98% velocity at VO2 max. Okay? And then, so you do 5 minute max for the repetition, and then you need rest in the middle of that repetition. And the rest should be approximately equal to the repetition time. Right? So if this guy's doing 1,000 meters, right, in 3:48, I'd give him a rest of 3:30. Rest, 3:30. Right? So 1,000 meters at 3:48 and rest of 3:30, and he's going to do that 4 or 5 times that. 4 or 5 repetitions of that workout. Does that make sense? Okay. So that's a VO2 max day. That's pretty typical. Then on Thursday, the second quality day of the week, we're doing LT runs again. Right, so you're doing repeat thousands with 1 minute rest in between, or you're doing a steady state tempo run of 20 minutes, maybe as much as 25. Okay. The psychological break that athletes get from that 1 minute rest is huge. And even though they'd be totally capable of running 20 minutes steady at their lactate threshold pace, the psychological benefit they get from getting a 1 minute break in between each repetition is enormous. It's really good. Okay, so that's phase three. And then we move on to phase four. Phase four is for sharpening, right? Sharpening your athletes. Now, I don't believe in tapering a high school athlete. And I don't think that their bodies are so well trained that tapering is going to make them significantly better. Right? Yeah, we take the last couple days off pretty light. You know, Bannister didn't run for 3 whole days before he broke the 4-minute mile. He didn't run at all, not a step. But here's a guy who was superbly trained and the first man to break 4 minutes. So we're not going to talk about tapering. We're talking about peaking, sharpening the athlete for those last couple days. So again, Monday, Wednesday, Friday are easy days. Tuesday, Thursday are quality days. Line those up in there. All right, so this is quality. And then I'm assuming that our super big race is on Saturday. I'm actually going to move it down. Sorry about that. We're going to race. Say these are the last, these are the first 3 weeks of phase four. Phase four. And these are the last 3 weeks. These 3 weeks will be basically identical. And then the fourth week, this is the final week of peaking. Right? So if this is your state meet, right, we've got a race there. So we've got quality days, Tuesday, Thursday, plus race on Saturday, plus whatever it is to equal about 90 minutes of running. So you might do a 60-minute long run in addition to the race that they run on Saturday. Or, well, they're going to warm up for a half hour before it, so probably a half hour cool down after. Okay, so I'll change my mind there and call it 30 minutes. Phase four. Quality days, we're going to start with a combination lactate threshold VO2 max workout. Okay. So what I like to do is I start with 2 by 800 LT with 1 minute rest. Okay. Then we do 2 by 800 VO2 with whatever the repetition time is, right? So let's say it's the same guy, 3:30 rest in between. And then we do 2 by 400 running economy, right? And for this guy, that was what, 121? Okay? So that it's increasing in speed, that's gear changing stuff. We'll do that, three of those, do that 2 by 800, 2 by 800, 2 by 400, shifting speeds, and then on Thursday, the Thursday quality day, we only do running economy stuff, and again, my staple workout, 2 by 200 plus 1 400, right? A bunch of sets of that, all that at running economy. And these aren't sprints, remember, they're just fast, steady, smooth repetitions. Easy? Okay, good. The final week, I like to move my quality day to Monday. Right, if it's a Saturday race, we'll do quality day Monday, and we're going to do this workout again. 2 by 800 LT, 2 by 800 VO2, and then 2 by 400 running economy. And then on Wednesday, we do an abbreviated version of the RE workout, the running economy workout, where we're just working on leg speed, keeping them loose. And then these 2 days are easy, 30 minutes, and this one maybe 20 minutes. A lot of times that last day before the big race, I have my kids come out, we warm up, stretch out, do a couple pickups, and go home. That's it. That's developing the season. And you know, each kid's ability level, again, will determine how fast he's or she is going to train during the week, right? It's all based on those percentages. Finally, I'm going to give you some resources that I think would be really valuable for your coaching, and we'll wrap it up. Probably the most valuable resource that you can give your athletes is a racing strategy. And I tell my athletes just a couple of things. If we're talking about 5 kilometers, and the first mile, aim for your threshold pace. Then, at the second mile mark, you're aiming for position. I read this in Daniels, and I've heard it from a lot of coaches. And the position that you're in at the two-thirds point in the race, right, the 2-mile mark in a 5K race, The position there is not going to change. You are not going to change drastically from the two-thirds pace, because wherever you're at, you can pretty much hang on to. Yeah, you might get outkicked, or you might outkick some people, but you can't make drastic changes. You can't make up lots and lots of ground on people, right, past the two-thirds mark. And that's kind of it. So I tell them to aim for those two things. The other thing is, you want to maintain contact. The surest way to lose a race to somebody is to let them get a gap on you longer than you can reach. If you can still hold on to their shoulder, you'll go with them. Right? There's this huge psychological benefit of hanging on to a runner who's doing a lot of work. And this is why front runners burn more energy than other people. It's not just because of drafting, you know, the amount of wind that they're blocking, but it's also because of how much work they're having to do to maintain their own pace. You can stick with somebody who's running slightly faster than you are pretty easily. Right? Or if a guy gets 10 yards ahead of you, or 10 feet ahead of you even, if you're not right next to him, you could go the same pace for the entire rest of the race and feel like you're not going to be able to close that gap. Another trick that I use in cross country is 800 meters from the finish. We go out and we guesstimate, right, because it's illegal to roll the course at some places, but guess where half mile to go is, and say this is the commitment point. This is the point of no return. Right? You're going to push from here to the finish. Don't give up any points the last 800 meters. We don't give up points the last 800 meters. Finally, for any distance race, and especially on the track, I like to divide the race into quarters. Right? And the third quarter of any distance race, whether it's the 800 meters, the mile, or the 2 mile on the track, the third quarter is the one that has to be the hardest. You've got to push hard the third quarter, otherwise you're just going to get beat up. And you've got to go that third quarter. Most people, that's their slowest race. Right? Just like in the 4x8, you put your weakest leg third. Or most of the relays, the general philosophy of coaching is that you may put your weakest leg third. But you've got to make that your strong leg. If you're a relay by yourself, right, a four by me, right, the third leg has got to be the one who fights the hardest. It's got to be the one who fights the hardest. Those are some racing strategies that I use. There's tons of tips everywhere. You know, look them up, but those are the ones that I like to use with my athletes. And then finally, I'll give you some resources that you should look up or go purchase for yourself to keep track of stuff. I think the most valuable resource that you can get for yourself is the book Daniel's Running Formula. Daniel's Running Formula. I use that book all the time. It's my main resource for training athletes. And I've got two editions of it. And this is the first edition. It's got Bob Kennedy on the cover. And the second edition is Alan Culpepper on the cover. This one is more simple than the second edition. It's a little bit more basic. This one has some more intricate, complex ways to develop your training schedules. They're both really great. And I highly recommend them both. That's what got me started as an effective coach. I had my first edition of Daniel's, I had my first edition of Daniel's spiral bound so that I could flip open the pages easily and fold them back, because I was always referring to this book. Right. Daniel's has charts for you, so you don't have to calculate all that stuff. You just, you know, you look up your athlete's race time on one page, identify the number that he says their fitness level is, and then flip to the other page where how fast they should train for each of those training paces is. That's a good resource. If you don't want to, calculate the training paces yourself, you can get one of these. It's called the Original Pace Wheel. The Pace Wheel. It's something I actually invented for my cross country team. You can see it hanging up here. It's a circular calculator. You just line up your kid's time in the purple windows, and it calculates for you all those five paces: aerobic training pace, marathon race pace, lactate threshold pace, VO2 max pace, and then your running economy repetitions. It's really pretty simple. You can order those at pacewheel.com. Other training books that I totally recommend for you are the USATF-Certified coaching manual. And I think it's called the Coach's Survival Guide. Now we're running out of time. Okay, the Coach's Survival Guide. These are great resources. The last thing I absolutely recommend to you is that you attend a USATF coaching school. It costs a little bit of money if you don't have one local to you, but it's absolutely worth doing for your own training and for the coaching that you intend to do. So, thank you very much for having me. I appreciate it. It's been an honor to get to teach here today, and I look forward to hearing from you in the future.